fungi are in nearly all plants. I would even say probably all plants. Plants are more like ecosystems for fungi and bacteria, just like humans and animals have bacteria on our skin and fungi on our skin. But plants are similar, but they also have the fungi all the way through the plant tissue.
We're interviewing scientists, pioneers, and Bento Lab users that are pushing the boundaries of accessible biotechnology. Today, I'm talking to Brian Douglas, who led the Lost and Found Fungi project at Kew Gardens and has recently joined us at Bento Lab. This video is brought to you by Bento Lab, a DNA analysis laboratory you can take anywhere.
My name's Brian Douglas. For the last 5 years, I've been working for the Royal Botanic Gardens Kew, coordinating the Lost and Found Fungi project. And a big part of this project involved trying to upskill and mentor the field mycology community so they can become more involved in finding species of fungi that are important, identifying them and protecting rarely recorded fungi. And a big part of this was trying to DNA enable some of these fungus groups so that they can confirm and do taxonomic work themselves on par with academic mycologists.
Up until I'd encountered the Lost and Found Fungi project, I wasn't really aware that there were so many different kinds of species. Why are fungi important?
Fungi are an organismal group that are equivalent to plants, animals, or bacteria. They're one of the major groupings of life on this planet. And they're absolutely essential to almost all of the interactions that happen within ecology. They're fundamentally important to the decomposition of organisms, of organic matter, and also in the recycling and upcycling of nutrients. And they're a massively diverse kingdom. I think there's over 140,000 species that have been described, but the estimate is somewhere along the lines of 3 million species thought to be existing in the world, most of which we don't really understand it at all. Fungi are absolutely essential to life, but because most of what they do is hidden away, either inside of soils or inside of plant material, we very rarely see them. And it's only when they fruit that we actually realize, actually, there's something here that's a form of life that's doing something. But all the time, fungi are in the ground, in plants, doing their thing and contributing to nutrient cycling, to feeding plants, to protecting plants against pathogens by triggering their immune systems. They infect insects. Some species can transfer nutrients from dead insects into plants. And within soils, there's an amazing trading network of different fungal species, all associated with different plants, feeding nutrients to each other in an enormously complicated fungal market. So fungi are everywhere. They do loads of different things. They're also important for humans because we get quite a few drugs for them, such as immunosuppressants. So if you have an organ replacement, one of the drugs that they'll give you is derived from a fungus. If you have a bacterial infection, they might give you penicillin, which is derived from penicillium, a fungus. So they're amazing chemical factories that we've only really started to try to use for the benefit of humans.
Tell me a bit more about Kew Gardens.
Kew Gardens is one of the centres of excellence and knowledge for plants and fungi in the United Kingdom. Kew Gardens holds an enormous herbarium for plants, and it also has an enormous fungarium for fungi, which is a collection of dried fungal material that has been identified, and it serves as a reference collection for an enormous number of species of fungi from the UK and globally as well. So it's a really important resource. And we also have active mycologists undertaking research at Kew. And Kew is also now increasingly getting involved in genome sequencing of fungi, because Kew Gardens holds essentially the Rosetta Stone of fungal knowledge in its fungarium. If people went through the fungarium and DNA barcoded it and genome sequenced everything in there, that would have so many different applications for knowledge of anything to do with fungi.
What exactly is the Lost and Found Fungi Project, and why did it get started?
One of the things that mycologists at Kew have always found is that there's an enormous demand in the UK mycological community among the amateur mycologists. the people who like going out and recording fungi, for the identification of more interesting specimens. But the number of mycologists is quite small, and there isn't quite enough capacity to deal with this sort of demand, and also to help encourage recording of fungi for conservation purposes. So 5 years ago, the Esme Fairbairn Foundation very generously funded a project at Kew called the Lost and Found Fungi Project. And this was a citizen science project aimed at trying to tackle some of the many problems that we have with fungal conservation in the UK. One of the things that we found that were particularly useful was providing training and mentoring for things like microscopy to help people microscopically identify fungi. But also towards the end of the project, we also started teaching field mycologists how to do their own DNA barcoding of fungi, because by doing so, they can identify species themselves on par with academic mycologists. And it seems to me to be the most efficient way to give our collaborators what they really want, but also to get the work done, because it's a lot easier to train field mycologists to do DNA work than it is to take a molecular biologist and teach them how to identify fungi.
Why is it so great that fungal recording groups are taking part in this? What's the advantage of having fungal recording groups also know how to use the tools for DNA barcoding?
The big advantage of training field mycologists to do DNA work is, first of all, there's far more of them in the world and in the UK than there are paid academic mycologists. So they probably outnumber them by 100 times overall. So field mycologists not only have enormously more collecting power, they also have a lot more time to do this work. Many are retired, and they've also had the time to build up the knowledge and skills to do morphological fungal identification. So in a way, by enabling 5 field mycologists, we've essentially increased the number of people who are barcoding by 5 times. And also with the younger people who have been getting involved in this sort of work, in 10 years' time, they'll be pretty amazing if they keep on doing this sort of work. So hopefully it will result in a major increase in the number of academic quality mycologists who have both field mycology skills and DNA-based skills.
What happens next for the Lost and Found Fungi project?
There's a lot of data analysis that needs to be published, and some final reports and a whole string of articles that will take a long time to write. But in terms of the DNA barcoding work that we've been doing, myself and the groups that we're working with are continuing that outside of Kew, looking for funding for barcoding, and we'll be trying to make something substantial out of all the results we've had so far and in the future that will be of benefit to the global mycological community.
I really like this idea of DNA enabling. Do you think that it would be relevant for other Bento Lab users, like citizen scientists in different fields?
So I think there's a lot of parallels between what we were doing with the Lost and Found Fungi project, DNA enabling the field mycologists, and what users of Bento Lab will be experiencing. A lot of people are going from no molecular biology knowledge, but expertise in other areas, to being able to do the basic methodologies and become able to produce data and information that's on par with academics. And in most cases, I think the expertise that people already have is something that's quite difficult and time-consuming to learn, just like learning how to identify fungi is difficult and time-consuming to learn. And the molecular biology part of it is just a really, really useful add-on.
People are interested in getting into fungi, where would you recommend they get started?
In the UK, I would recommend people look up the British Mycological Society. They've got their own website. They've also got a very active Facebook page, so I'd recommend they look that up. If people are interested in getting involved in fungi around the world, there are loads of different fungus interest groups on Facebook. So that's a really, really good start. If people are interested in doing fungal DNA barcoding, there's also a Facebook page called Fungal Sequencing, which is coordinated by Alan Rockefeller, who's one of the field mycologists in North America, who's several years ahead of us, him and his colleagues and network, in terms of fungal DNA barcoding as a sort of citizen science kind of thing. And in North America, there's also the Fungal Diversity Survey, and that's essentially where we'd like to be with UK fungal barcoding in a couple of years' time.
Well, Brian, thanks so much for taking time to talk to me about the Lost and Found Fungi project. I'm really excited that you're going to be joining us at Bento Lab to work on DNA enabling and bringing all of that perspective with you. So yeah, thanks again for taking time to tell me a bit more about it.
Thank you, Bethan, for having me.
You can find out more information about the Lost and Found Fungi project in the description below. And if you've got any questions for Brian, please leave him a comment. If you liked this video, give us a thumbs up and please support us by subscribing to the channel. Thanks and see you next week.